Welcome, one and all, to the third dimension of what we call ELL dimensions, that is, leading through conflict. There'll be a couple of things which I would like to elaborate before we move ahead with the topic as such. The cheapest thing, money-wise, is knowledge. The most invaluable thing, money-wise, is also knowledge. You might find it to be inherently contradictory, but I'll just elaborate the genesis of this lecture. I went to Bangalore on 25th, 26th of December, if my memory serves me right at this age. And there's a book sale organized by Stafford Bookstall or something. I went there, I thought of doing a nice bargain, and I got this book for 250 rupees on sale. This book has had a transformational impact. My thought process, though it is written for management students or management practitioners, I am convinced of the fact that the genesis of this book lies somewhere in internal security. Through this book, I went through this book, I got fascinated, and having running this lecture series, I thought, why not use this topic, introduce this topic to high-end professionals who are struggling with their lives day in and day out because they are not conflict-enabled. In the very same manner, you can be literate. Simultaneously, you can be digitally illiterate. In the very same manner, in a conflict-ridden society, economy, and polity, if you are not conflict-enabled or not conflict-literate, the only fate which befalls you is crisis day in and day out. You become evasive, and you finally land your organization, the society, the state, the nation, and the world at large into one crisis after another. I have nobody to comment on what the earlier US president decided after 9/11, but strategic experts across the globe are of the opinion that that single decision has filled more fire to terrorism rather than curbing it. Which brings us to the main issue of today's deliberations, that is, whether we as leaders can we ever progress, can we ever grow into leaders who have holistic concept, who can understand the totality, who have vision, who have ideas, who have systems thinking, who can think what is good for the world. The life affirming values, not to hurt but to heal, not for victory but for justice, not for our rights but for the rights of all, not just for our side but for the whole, of which we are only a small and fragile part. What we have been doing all the while is fighting our own singular battles. What we have seen all our life is a very clear-cut effort to demarcate, to divide societies, to divide organizations, and finally inculcate a thought process which does not go above and beyond. As I've already said, that this topic, to best of my understanding, and because of the training and expertise which I have, I treat it as a topic which has huge amount of internal security content in it. We'll move into the topic slightly later. The purpose of this lecture is to make the skills of the mediator more accessible to every person who wants to deal more effectively and creatively with the conflict of his or her life. Next. This is where we are. It would be very difficult to decide as to which one of us does not grapple with conflict day in and day out. So we are living in a world which is ridden with crisis. People generally feel crisis means it should have a violent manifestation. There are convents, there are churches, there are spiritual organizations, there are religious organizations. They are ridden with more crisis than what political organizations and the general political systems are. There's just a misnomer that crisis strikes the public domain, which is seen on the TVs day in and day out. There are people grappling with crisis in a much worse manner than what we do in the public domain. So these are a couple of leaders who have been leading in different styles. They have been leading the world. And hopefully we have more of them who are there to unite the world. There is a lady from Albania who worked all her life in India. And crisis need not necessarily be a political crisis. Poverty is the biggest crisis the world faces today. Terrorism is the biggest crisis the world faces today. AIDS is another crisis which all of us face. And last but not the least, it is illiteracy of every kind which stalks nearly every mind in this nation and across the globe. So what has changed? Over the years, what has changed? As our world grows smaller, opportunities for conflict multiply. Ethnic, religious, political, and personal differences drive people apart with potentially disastrous consequences, and it's the task of perceptive leaders to bring them together again. Renowned mediation expert Mark Zagon argues that leaders have failed to rise to the challenge. We might have a political party which rules the state. We might have a MLA or MP who represents a constituency. You can ask any one of them, when they go back to their constituencies, more often than not, they interact with the people who belong to their political party. More often than not, you go to your constituencies, even if you are a minister who is taking care of some department across the country. Only in the recent Delhi incident, there is absolutely no disagreement regarding the facts of the case, regarding the direction in which the country should go, regarding the collaboration of organizations, agencies, and so on and so forth. Still, what we saw on a day in, day out basis, on a nearly 24/7 basis, was argument, argument, argument. To the extent that all those arguments were left by the wayside, if we see Justice J.S. Verma's report. Somewhere we have to decide that all our constructive energies, does it allow us to understand the whole? Does it allow us to understand what this country is all about? What our society is all about? Or we are here to fight our own battle, fight our caste's battle, fight our organization's battle, and within the organization again fight your own battle? That itself is not the end. A great author, great academician, and he has written a book which has revolutionized the basic concept of how a conflict should be handled. It is the leader-centric approach to conflict which has added a completely new dimension to conflict management and conflict resolution. There might be any number of schools of thought, management and otherwise, to handle conflicts. But concentrating on precisely two things, one is the leader and the second is the conflict. They're just two epicenters, and a right connect between the two will help you resolve the crisis. This is my opinion regarding Mark Gezon. Has immense international exposure, experienced exposure and expertise and has developed a mediator model of leading through conflict, which can be achieved through 8 tools, all soft skills. For the first time, we are defining tools as soft skills. We have graduated to a different level of civilization. We have graduated to a different level of professionalism, where conflict can be resolved by soft tools and not only by tanks, missiles, and whatever. A combination of which can lead to innovative, transformational resolution of the conflict. It has to be innovative and it has to be transformational. And with innovative and transformational, there is something else which also follows these two words, and that is, it should have some level of permanence. There are large number of treaties, there are large number of agreements, there are large number of compromises which are broken before they are made. We are very familiar with type of leaders we have in the political field, in the social field, in the economic field. What we need today is a leadership. What we need today is a leadership that is ready to face the challenges of global economics and politics. There has been a huge debate of late to allow foreign companies in India's retail. A small kirana store in a remote town can feel the heat of the biggest multinational on the retailing side. So the only way out is to negotiate. But for negotiation, you will not be able to do anything. And the only other thing which you can do is participate in talk shows. So that liberty you have. If you don't have anything else to do, so certainly you can get into talk shows. We had a system wherein the leaders, wherein the senior managers, wherein the business leaders, they passed instructions, they passed orders, and it was complied with. That was the system of management which we have followed across the ages, across the decades, across the centuries. Now they say that that system does not hold good. There is a riot agitation going on right here itself. In the riot agitation, there are 5-7 stakeholders. Now who can issue orders to whom? You yourself can give it a thought. So from being a linear, vertical, pyramidical organization, what is happening today, we are becoming non-hierarchical. It is a network. It is a network of stakeholders. We are enmeshed in different social economic relationship, and that your stake and your capability to influence that whole, the whole stakeholders, that will decide whether you are a successful leader or you are not a successful leader. We will be getting into leaders of different types. But as management people talk about, we will start with the business leaders. So this emanates out of a study done on business leaders across the globe. And that is precisely the center point, the theme of a book called Will to Last. That throws up a level 5 leadership. And a level 5 leadership is a man who is extremely ambitious, not for himself, but for the organization. And that has it is blended with extreme personal humility. Can anyone in this august audience claim that he or she is not leading a life of conflict? Is there anybody? Somewhere, the world has become a melting pot. There were places where you didn't find any outsiders. There were places we didn't find any external influences. There was a small place like Davangere. There are how many countries represented here? Yes, sir, how many? 15, 20 countries? So this is where we stand. All of us are left with no choice. We have to get into this globalized economy, globalized society. And side by side with that, we will deliver what we are supposed to deliver. This whole leadership lecture will take you through the different types of leadership. And also will take you further into the great soft skills which we are talking about. The structure of the presentation would be dealing with three types of leaders, that is the demagogues, the managers, and the mediators, followed by eight different types of soft tools. These will be the soft tools which will help you in different permutation combination to help you become a leader of modern times, who can see the world and not just their nation of origin, interest, and the worldview. So finally, what it means is to transcend. Finally, what it means is to transcend the boundaries. So those are your mental boundaries. Those are not the physical boundaries. Those boundaries, unless you transcend, you will not be able to provide a resolution to the conflict which you are in. This is very, very beautifully articulated by a couple of lines, which are the principles of integral vision. Faced with silence and secrecy, do everything publicly. Faced with silence and secrecy, do everything publicly. Most of the things we do, we are faced with silence and secrecy. In the public domain, all of you are aware, there is no need to come up with examples. Faced with fear, be sincere and dialogue. When you are afraid, when you don't know what to do, you dialogue. Something will certainly come out of it. Faced with violence, talk and negotiate with everyone. And faced with exclusion, find support in others. Most of the causes we proclaim, these are the causes of exclusion. We are not able to get people who align to our ideas. We are not able to find support systems which can be aligned to our thought process. So this tool of integral vision, it is for everybody. Everybody requires homeland, security, incident, and response management system. Correct. This is a long tunnel by which I will be able to reach there. And also create an ERP for the whole of Indian governance with the integration of the legacy systems. So this is what is my vision. Now, have we, for any of the conflicts which are plaguing us on a day-to-day basis, have we put our integral vision anywhere? Have we even proclaimed our integral vision? Leave aside finding a way to reach that integral vision. Next slide. To reach that integral vision. So we generally lack this great soft skill of integral vision. Let me make one thing very, very clear to you, that all these tools will come to you only when you are academically bright and you are a practitioner who has come through the arduous and hazardous way. If you sit down in an AC room, or if you are an armchair academician, or even an armchair practitioner, these tools will never come to you, because neither will you know the basics, the precursors, the back-end processes to reach those tools. Then there is no question of picking up these tools, and there is absolutely no way out by which you can use these tools at all. So this is the strength of integral vision. As I told you, George W. Bush, he went on to invade Iraq. His vision was not integral, they say. And later, it was also thought that he lacked systemic thinking. In one of the presidential debates or some conference, I think he was not able to say where Sri Lanka was or Pakistan was, something of that nature. By failing to use the tool of integral vision, the leader of the world's most powerful democracy launched on a war of terror, but instead, according to many international security specialists, actually made matters worse.